A November morning, not so very long ago.
As I leave you, I want you to know you won't have Dick Nixon to kick around anymore.
Dick, what are you doing?
Pat, I am rehearsing my concession speech.
But Dick, you're winning.
I was winning the other times, too.
But this time, it really looks good. I'll put on the radio.
Precincts from Illinois, our computer has placed it firmly in the Nixon column, which means that Richard M. Nixon is the next president.
You won, you won.
I am the president. The president of the United States. Well, you can't lose them all. Well, I certainly hope that Lyndon's at home.
It's 4 o'clock in the morning. Where else would he be? I still say we should have called first.
Pat, I considered the options, and after much thought, I made a decision. A dime is a dime. Ring the bell. Make a note, that bell has got to go. Now, Pat, whatever you do, don't tell him that I've never been above the first floor.
All right, I won't tell him you've never been above the first floor.
Who is it, Lyndon?
How do I know what idiot would come a-calling at 4 o'clock in the morning? Is that you, Hubert?
No, sir, it's Dick and Pat.
It's Pick and Pat.
No, Dick and Pat, the president-elect and Mrs.-elect.
Welcome to the White House. And please pardon my nightcap and my boots. What can I do for you?
Well, we got the election returns this morning. I got here as fast
as I could. I understand you wanting to look the place over. But you've been to the White House before, haven't you, Dick?
Yes, but he's never been above the first floor.
All right, I'll give you the tour. Stop kissing my hand. The tour is $2. Thank you, Dick. Company coming up, Lady Bird. Beautify yourself. Get in my elevator.
I want to say that I'm deeply honored to be in the White House elevator.
I'm deeply thrilled to be riding in the White House elevator.
I'm pleased as punch to be running the White House elevator.
On the ceiling is a hand-painted mural of Lyndon Baines Johnson throwing a silver dollar across the pernail.
How lifelike.
That's got to go.
Under your feet is the Lyndon Baines Johnson commemorative carpet.
How lifelike.
That has got to go.
And in that bed is the world famous Lyndon Baines Johnson presidential missus.
Hi.
How lifelike.
That has certainly got to go.
Hi, nice to see you.
what lovely decor.
Now let's talk about our priorities. The bed goes, the branding iron goes, the hitching post goes. I stay. But leave the horse, Lyndon. I intend to be an activist president.
If I leave my horse, how do I get home? To Texas.
I'm glad you asked me that question. I have a car I'm not going to be using. Now, maybe I could sell it to you. White walls, low mileage, radio, heater, easy payments.
Buy a used car from you? No way. Dick, it's 4 a.m. And it is with a heavy heart that I say get.
Well, let me make one thing clear, Lyndon. We are going to be the new tenants, and I say to you with great sincerity that I hope we'll be very happy here.
So those are the new tenants.
Yeah.
Well, there goes the neighborhood.
Rocky, I would like to thank you on behalf of me and all the people across this great land for taking that goodwill trip to South America. Put down your crutches and tell me all about it.
Well, why should I tell you about it? Why don't I just show you? I've got some slides. I've got some color slides.
Grand. I'm sure it wasn't a picnic. From personal experience, I know that. You know, I was once stoned in Venezuela.
Well, I didn't have time for that. I just went around trying to find out how much our amigos love us south of the border. Here's my first slide. That's our reception at the airport in Ecuador.
Who are those colorful people, and whatever are they doing?
Those are the natives in their quaint and colorful ponchos, and they're punching us. This is our reception in Colombia.
Beautiful color, Governor. Just beautiful.
Dumb luck. I snapped it just as a ripe guava hit the land. And here I am dickering in the picturesque marketplace in Maracaibo.
What are you dickering for?
I'm dickering for my life. Here I am in Valparaiso.
That's Chile, isn't it?
No, actually, we're being pelted with enchiladas here. Here I am surrounded by a group of waving natives.
What is it that they're waving?
My clothes.
Is that it? I mean, is that about it?
From here on, it was all downhill.
Well, thanks, Rocky. It was very brave of you to take this trip. I didn't want to send you, but I needed the information. I mean, put yourself in my place.
I tried, Dick. Believe me, I tried.
Is that you, Mr. President?
Yes, Pat, it is me, Mr. President.
Oh, Dick, good news. Julie dropped in.
Hello, dear.
Hello, Father.
Where's your better half, Julie?
Oh, he's in the kitchen, Dad, getting us some warm milk and oatmeal cookies.
Are they spiced?
Oh, Dad. Really? Oh, here comes David now.
Good evening.
Well, an especial good evening to you, sir. Well, here's the milk, and there's plenty for everybody.
Grand, just grand. Milk, milk. Milk is what the Calcells drink.
Oh, sir, before you have your cookie, may I ask you something?
Certainly, by all means.
Well, would it be all right, sir, if I, well, if I called you Dad?
Dad. You know, I can't tell you how happy that would make me, Mr. Eisenhower. Bill, I'm certainly glad that you could come.
Mr. President, you know I'll do anything for your administration.
Thanks. Now, this is urgent, Bill. We need your advice. What should the first astronaut who steps onto the surface of the moon say? Now, we need, shall we say, historic words.
Mr. President, have any astronauts have any idea at all?
Well, not exactly. Here's what they've come up with. Shucks. And hey, I'm on the moon. But hold it. They're nice guys. They're very nice guys.
Mr. President, did you, speaking ex officio, have any thoughts of your own?
Well, I personally did have a thought of my own. I thought they should say, I am the first man on the moon, and make no mistake about that.
Well, that's very, very good. Wait, an idea does germinate within. Now, when he steps down into the Sea of Tranquility, pardon me, Mare Tranquillitate. He says, that's one small step for man, one giant step for Homo perfecto, candido, it lib, quid, proto, first, quibus.
Mr. President, the Prime Minister of Israel is due any minute, and we've prepared a briefing for you.
I don't have to be briefed. I'm well acquainted with the importance of that valiant little nation, that bastion of freedom in the Middle East, and that large Jewish vote across this great land. But I'll talk to him anyway.
Well, Mr. President, it's not a him. The Prime Minister of Israel is Mrs. Golda Meir.
On the other hand, perhaps I ought to be briefed.
Anything you say, Mr. President.
Who's conducting the briefing, Jake Javits?
No, you'll be briefed by one of the most distinguished members of the Jewish community, and one hell of a singer, and here he is now.
Well, thank you, Mr. President. This is Uncle Georgie with the briefing.
Sir, would you start with some basic vocabulary? What should the president say when he greets Mrs. Meir?
Well, the proper Hebrew words for hello is shalom.
And the word for goodbye?
The words for goodbye, shalom.
Well, how do I tell which is which?
Well, if she leaves after you've said it, you said goodbye.
That's quite interesting, of course. A But, you know, I happen to already know quite a few phrases of the Hebrew persuasion. For instance, I have been frequently told that I have a great deal of chutzpah.
That's chutzpah, sweetheart. Chutzpah. Mr. President, you should not offer Mrs. Mayer ham or pork.
Why? Is she on a diet?
Look who I'm talking to. Mr. President, there are such things as dietary laws.
Of course. You forget that I lived in New York City. And if there's one thing that I learned, it's how people of the Hebrew persuasion ate. I'm going to take Mrs. Mayer to a Chinese restaurant.
Mr. President, Mrs. Mayer is here.
Bring her in. Shalim, Shalim, Shalo.
Madame Golda Mayer.
Golda, sweetie!
Mrs. Mayer, on behalf of the American people, Shamo. Pat, it's 10 a.m., and it's time for my second shave of the day. Mirror, mirror, on the bathroom wall, who's the president of them all?
Richard Milhouse Nixon.
Thank you, Mira. Now, where did Pat put my shaving cream?
Hi, guy. One shot, you're good for the whole day. Bet you didn't expect to find me on the other side of your medicine chest.
Of course I did.
Scrum, we've got to stop meeting like this.
All right, send a man. Have a seat, Spiro. Do you see this folder on my desk? He has daily reports from the CIA, the Secret Service, and your nanny. It informs me of your comings and goings. Now, Spiro, if you remember our last meeting, you are not allowed comings and goings. You are supposed to stay in your apartment.
Except on Saturday afternoon.
Right, except on Saturday when you go to the movies with the children of the White House staff. Stop playing with your toes, Spiro. Now, Spiro, I am the president.
Make no mistake about that.
I say that, not you. I am the president. I make the speeches. Now, Spiro, why did you go out and make a speech?
Well, I wanted someone to talk to.
Won't my son-in-law, Mr. Eisenhower, talk to you anymore?
Well, he uses small words. I use big words like impudent and defeat and...
Spiro, do you know how much I have to pay Mr. Eisenhower to talk to you?
A lot. I know that a lot.
A bundle! And I'm not a rich man, let me tell you that right now. I know what it means to be poor. That's why I'm president. Ask anybody, they'll tell you I'm a poor president. Spiro, never repeat that, never.
Never repeat what?
Never mind.
Dick, tell me about the rabbits.
I already told you about the rabbits. Spiro, why do you like to make speeches?
Every time I make a speech, people laugh at what I say.
And why do they laugh, do you think?
Because I'm nice and jolly, and people like to laugh.
No, Spiro, no. You laugh because you said, I get this now, you said you like the 11 o'clock news better than the 6 o'clock news because 11 is twice as much as 6. Now, get that. so you get twice as much news, Spiro. Do you know how to tell time, Spiro?
I'm not sure.
I'll show you. Hold out your watch. No, your watch on your wrist. Good, Spiro, good. Now, get this now. When Mickey's big hand is pointing straight up and the little hand is pointing straight down, what time is it?
Thursday.
Spiro, I'm going to ask Mr. Eisenhower to teach you telling time and the days of the week and the months.
Colors. I want to learn colors. Colors.
All right. He'll teach your colors.
Hooray.
But you've got to promise no more speeches, and if you don't make any more speeches, we're going to do something really nice for you.
What?
We're going to give you a brain transplant and make you much smarter than you are today.
Well, where will you get the brain?
From a chicken.
Take a postcard. Dear Henry Cabot, having wonderful time. Wish you were vice president.
I have the report on Operation Intercept, Mr. President. It's a huge success.
Then you've stopped the flow of marijuana.
Completely. Tourist traffic hasn't moved in days. The president of Mexico is threatening to break off diplomatic relations. Not only that, we seized 3 joints.
Joints. Now, let me understand that. Now, what are joints?
You got to be kidding, sir.
Jones, I never kid. I have a wonderful sense of humor, and I tell hilarious jokes, but I never kid. Now, what is a joint?
A joint, sir, is a marijuana cigarette.
I always thought they were called roofers.
Well, sir, here are the 3 roofers we confiscated. They retail for about 50 cents apiece.
Now, Jones, let me say this. If I gave you 50 cents...
Sir, I brought these roofers with me because the department thought it would be a good idea if you tried one before you drafted your drug bill. We felt that you might have more insight into the problem if you turned on.
I turned on whom?
Well, turning on means to get high.
I am hep. Now, let's have one of those joints, baby.
Here.
That's good.
Sir, you're not supposed to eat it. You smoke it.
I've already swallowed it. Give me another one.
All right. Here, now, sir, when I light it, you're supposed to inhale like this. And you hold the smoke in your lungs as long as possible.
Now, let's go, Jones. I'm getting up close.
You mean up tight?
Whatever. Oh. Come on, light my fire.
There we go.
I swallowed that one, too.
Oh, boy. Here's another one, sir. It's already lit. How do you feel, sir?
I feel wonderful. This is heavy grass. It must be Acapulco Gold. Jones, I believe I'm beginning to hallucinate.
But, sir, you're not supposed to hallucinate on pot.
Don't tell me. I hallucinate on Dr. Pepper.
Well, tell me, sir, what do you see?
Well, it's beautiful, Jones. I see spacious skies and fruited plains. And amber waves of grain. Wait a minute. Now I see colors. Colors!
Red, white, and blue, sir?
No, no. I see brown. Terrible, depressing brown. I see Pat Brown. And he's winning. He's going to be the governor of California.
Are you all right, sir?
Jones, I think I'm having a bum voyage.
Just relax, sir. I'm here with you.
Wait a second. Everything's changed. Now I'm in a big house, in a big, big office.
That's right, sir. You're right here, where you've always wanted to be, and you're in charge.
You mean?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Then I made it. I actually made it at last. I'm governor of California. Why, Billy Graham, you old crusader. what are you doing in Washington?
I was about to ask you the same thing.
I'm here on government business.
Well, how's everything at home? Your lovely wife, your lovely children, your lovely cabinet, yay, and the beasts of the forest, and the lilies of the field, unto the fourth generation. Verily, Dick, verily.
Everything's fine.
Now, I'm glad I ran into you, Richard. Richard, you're the only one I can talk to about this. Last night as I watched the sermonette, lo, mine eyes grew heavy, and mine head did nod, and mine hands fell to mine side.
You mean you fell asleep? Billy, don't worry about it. Your secret is safe with me. I can assure you of that.
Richard, I know. But did you happen to see that sermonette?
You may be absolutely sure that I did.
Then perhaps you can tell me how it turned out.
I'd be very happy to tell you that. They finally get to Bethlehem, and they named him Jesus.
Then it was a boy. Hallelujah!
Mr. President, I didn't know you were still here.
Oh, that's all right. You can clean up. I'm just writing the nuclear proliferation treaty. Well, do me a favor. Work around me, and don't touch my yellow pad.
Do you want me to dust the treaty?
No, that's all right.
But
don't bother dusting the treaty.
I always dusted Mr. Roosevelt's treaties.
Well, you must have been here quite a number of years, dear.
Yes, ever since Coolidge. proliferation is spelled with one F.
Thank you very much. What is your name, dear?
Mary Catherine O'Flaherty.
Nice to meet you. I'm the president of the United States. By the way, what are they saying about me?
Who?
You know, the people like you who work in the White House, the little people.
Well, you haven't been here long, but I can tell you this, they love your suit. pardon me, sir, about paragraph 3. Do you think Russia's going to buy on-site inspection the way you describe it there?
You might be right. What else do they say about me?
Well, they say you're better than some and worse than others.
Who am I better than?
Millard Fillmore.
Millard Fillmore. Now, who else am I better than?
Yes, well, I'm finished in here. Oh, by the way, sir, Paragraph 6 is already covered in the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty.
Never mind the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. Who else am I better than?
Good night, Mr. President.
Hello, Okasigan? No, I haven't finished the final draft yet. Well, you see, I just met with one of my top advisors. And the treaty still needs a little more work.
My friends and fellow Americans, I have been asked tonight to say just a few words. By golly, I'm going to try my darndest. And yes, my fellow Americans, I shall be brief. I also shall be terse, succinct, short-winded, and economical of both word and phrase and sentence and paragraph.
Those of us who heard that man speak and speak and speak have often wondered, what could he be thinking as he talks and talks and talks and talks? Now the answer to that question.
As I gaze across this broad and beautiful land of ours, on this wide and wonderful world, in this superb and splendid solar
system,
golly, what
a chatterbox
I am!
And
glorious galaxy we live in, I often find myself saying, "Gracious me, yes, gracious me."
Short, Hubert, short.
And I suppose you wonder why. Why, you wonder, does Hubert Horatio Humphrey say, "Gracious me"? I'll tell you why.
Oh,
my
shut up,
Americans.
Hubert. Shut up already.
I'll tell you why Hubert Humphrey says, "Gracious me," as he gazes across this broad and beautiful land and this wide and wonderful world.
Hubert, shut up already.
In this superb and splendid solar system of this grand and glorious galaxy we live in.
Didn't I just say that?
He says it because
you're
he believes.
You're going to give me hell for
gracious
this.
Gracious me. Now I shall be brief. But let me say this. And I feel I can say this without fear of interruption.
Oh, they're coughing.
Yes,
I've never seen people coughing
Americans
and sleeping at the same
I'm
time.
I'm pleased as punch to hear me say it. Now let me say this in conclusion. Let me
thank God,
you
I think I'm finishing at last.
This penultimate expletive. Heavens to Betsy. Heavens to Betsy. Let me amplify.
Wrong again, Hubert.
By heavens to Betsy, I mean to express the joy. And as I was saying to Mrs. Humphrey the other day,
oh, well.
Golly gee, Mom, what a thrill it is to gaze across the broad prairies and the wide savannas and the rushing rivers and to say, gosh, all
my
hemlock.
God, I'm a
what
bore.
A thrill it is just to live with and be joyous and to say happiness.
My gracious, friends, I'm just getting started and everyone's gone. Uriel,
thing.
Come back, you fool, come back.
I shall be brief. But first, let me just say a few words more. My friends,
and now my fellow Americans, the awards for the best performance by a politician during the last year. Some of the nominees are George Wallace in The Great White Hope.
Harold Stassen in The Magnificent Obsession.
Hubert Humphrey in Seduced and Abandoned. I don't think that's so funny.
Fidel Castro in One of Our Aircraft is Missing.
And General Curtis LeMay in Oh, What a Lovely War. I don't think that's so funny.
The envelope, please. And the winner is Mrs. Spiro Agnew in The Egg and I.
Accepting the award for Mrs. Agnew is her husband, Spiro. However, Spiro has been unavoidably restrained. Would someone like to come up and say a few kind words for the Vice President? Our next category is...
This is comedian Tom O'Malley, and I'm here at a swell gas station on the outskirts of Washington posing as an attendant. Now, this gas pump is actually a microphone. That fire hydrant is actually a camera, and I'm actually doing this for money. Oh, wait a minute. Here comes a real pigeon now, eh?
I would like 2 gallons of super swell gasoline, please.
Let me ask you something, pal. Why did you roll in here?
I understand that you give free dishes.
You put this junk in your tank just for some lousy dishes? Now, I know what goes into this stuff. Believe me. What do you know about Super Swell?
Well, I've seen your commercials on TV, the one where the car with the Platform 7 goes on for miles, while the car without the Platform 7 runs out of gas halfway across the Golden Gate Bridge. And my friend, I know what it means to run out of gas in California.
Hey, pal, do you know what this isn't by hand?
Of course I do. It's a gas pump.
No, you're wrong. It's a microphone. And that's a camera over there, a TV camera.
My fellow Americans, let me make one thing perfectly clear. The dishes were not for me. Let me just say that. These are for President Two and Vice President Key. And I want to say this, I'm getting 2 for Key and 3 for 2. It's me for you and you for me. Shalom. I got it right. I got it right at last. Take a letter, dear Dick. I think you're doing a magnificent job. Your public appearances are quite exciting. You are what I would call an activist president. I'll read that back and give it some feeling.
Mr. President, your visitors are here. Shall I show them in?
Of course.
This way, gentlemen. Mr. President, Mr. George Benson and Mr. Bruce Forrest.
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Good afternoon, Mr. President.
Gentlemen, refresh my memory. What is the name of your organization?
Mr. President, we represent an oppressed minority group. We're from the Gay Liberation Front.
The Gay Liberation Front. I was under the impression that I was going to see 2 gentlemen from United Fruit.
Oh,
for that too, Mr. President.
Yeah. I'm beginning to get the picture. Now, what did you want to see me about?
Sir, we have been systematically excluded from government. We want representation, and we want it now. We want at least one member of our minority group in your cabinet.
You already have that. At cabinet meetings, someone keeps touching my knee.
I knew she was one of us.
Who is it? Who is it?
My lips are sealed.
Bruce, please. Mr. President, what sort of positive action are you going to take?
Well, gentlemen, let me make one thing perfectly clear. Clear. Your president doesn't want to offend anyone. That's not my game. I have great respect for your people. Some of my best friends are choreographers. Your people have great talent, and I admire you all. You have such wonderful sense of hairdressing. However, let me make this very, very clear. I will not bow to pressure. I will not be bullied.
Get her.
Who? Get who?
Sir, we're merely asking for you to keep your campaign promises.
Mr. Benson, when I promised that I would bring everyone together, I'm afraid you took me too literally.
Then you're unwilling to do anything?
Gentlemen, I'm terribly sorry. I can do nothing for you.
Sir, it has been estimated that 6 million of our people will vote in 1972. That's 6 million.
6 million, you say? Now, let me say this. Mr. Benson,
You deliver those votes, and I can promise you a very, very big job.
As what?
As Majority Whip. President.
I am the president.
I like that.
Like that.
I am the president.
I am the president.
I am the greatest president who ever lived. Well?
Sorry, I'm an echo, not an idiot.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, that's me. Are there any questions?
Sir, I have a question. Mr. President, a recent poll showed that only 57% of the people felt that you were doing a good job as president. How do you comment on that?
Well, let me say this. The fact is, and I do believe in facts, because after all, I am the president, and that's a fact. Next question.
President, you haven't answered my question.
That is also a fact. The gentleman from the Bantu Journal.
Oh, yes. Mr. President.
Would you please stand up?
I am standing up.
I'm terribly sorry about that.
It's all right, sir. Mr. President, your critics claim that you have appointed very few blacks. Would you comment?
Well, that's not quite true. I have appointed blacks. Recently, I appointed Shirley Temple black. Next question.
Mr. President, why have we heard so little from Spiro Agnew recently?
Because you haven't been reading the papers. But seriously, let me say this. Spiro Agnew is the vice president. Make no mistake about that. I already did that. I have not gagged Spiro Agnew. Spiro Agnew has a vital part to play in this administration. And as soon as we find out what it is, he's going to rejoin the team. Next question.
Mr. President, where do you stand on school segregation?
I'm glad you asked me that question. I've said before, it seems to me there are two extreme groups. There are those who want instant integration and those who want segregation forever. I believe that we need to have a middle course, instant forever. Mr. Susskind, what is your question?
Mr. President, how can you, just how, what do you say? How can you answer your critics? Can you answer your critics who charge? I mean, what do you say to them?
I'll answer the second part of that question first. I'll answer the third part of the question second. I'll answer the first part of the question fourth.
I think you've answered my question.
Mr. President, what is an acceptable level of unemployment?
Well, let me say right off that most of my friends are working. But let me say this at the same time, an acceptable level of unemployment is something about which men may differ. A level of unemployment that is acceptable to one man may not be acceptable to the next man. Actually, it depends on whether you have a job. And I'm working. Make no mistake about that. I'm working. Your question, sir.
Mr. President, I'm Henry Fonda.
Well, it's a great honor to have you, Mr. Fonda, but let me make one thing perfectly clear, Mr. Fonda. This is a press conference, not a movie set.
Well, I know that, Mr. President, but just let me say this. I'm here because the reporters are a little hesitant about asking you this. You see, sir, you're always saying, let me make one thing perfectly clear. Let me make one thing perfectly clear. Frankly, it's a pain to keep hearing that over and over and over. Doesn't seem to me that it's necessary to keep saying, let me make one thing perfectly clear.
Well, let me make one thing perfectly clear. It may not be necessary for you to say it, Henry, but it's necessary for me to keep saying, let me make one thing perfectly clear.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Who am I?
I'm sorry, you're the president, Mr. President.
All right. Now, all together, who am I?
You are the president!
Yes, I am the president of the United States, and make no mistake about that.
And God help us, everyone.